The autumn fog has the southern Palatinate firmly in its grip, but I still have to get out. My DIY trailer, the Mouse, is quickly packed. A maximum of 50 kilometers around my hometown is the target. I want to spend the night 5 times in interesting places to film a different type of bird each day. Will it succeed? Stay tuned and let me surprise you. I choose my first overnight stop less than 20 minutes from home. As a wildlife filmmaker, you invest a lot of time in an unknown area without any reliable people. Also, exploring in a foreign country, it's fun and you usually meet very interesting people. But the pandemic situation currently dictates other rules of the game. So I'm just taking advantage of the home bonus. Before going to bed, of course, there's a ritual evening coffee or whatever you dare to call the thin milk-based drink. I'm standing on a very intensively used agriculture area. The huge monocultures are separated by an area of orchards and bushes in a north-south direction. This is very narrow, about 50-20 meters, but at least it provides a modest living for some animals. It usually shelves here all year round. Not so today. It's cold and wet, the sky is overcast, a strange atmosphere. The wildlife is probably also waiting for the weather to improve. I hear and see nothing, so I have breakfast and wait. The Palatinate Forest is the largest continuous forest area in Germany. The hilly foothills to the Rhine Plain are famous for intensive vine growing. A dubious fame, because a lot of chemical are used to cultivate the grapes. Here I would also like to refer you to my video on the bee eaters. The ornithologist John Weiss explains very clearly why exactly no bee eaters breed in the southern Palatinate. But they are local rays of hope, because some farmers have joined forces and planted so-called flower strips in some places. This is at least a start. The rustic breakfast is ready by now and the camera is also ready. Actually, this is a good place to observe animals at almost any time of the year. They are used to people here, so there is no need to camouflage yourself. Only today this calculation doesn't work out. Only after hours do I discover a lone great tit. We need to continue planning anyway, especially as the first day's task has been completed. I don't have a fixed itinerary. The local weather conditions will be the determining factor for the destination in the next few days. In the early afternoon, I get the mouse ready for the journey. In moments like these, I realize that my decision to equip this small luggage trailer to meet my need was the right one. It only takes me a few minutes to set off, and once I'm there I have maximum mobility with the trailer. Anyway, now I'm off towards the sun, because the weather is supposed to be better on the highest mountain in the Palatinate forest. Of course, the 672 meter high Kalmit cannot compete with its big relatives from the Alps, but it is always worth a visit. So I set off up there with the mouse in tow. Apart from a few cyclists, I'm pretty much alone. An unusual sight, because without the pandemic, this is a touristic hotspot. Well rested, I'm greeted by a blackbird at my morning coffee. Strictly speaking, the goal for the day had already been reached, but there is certainly more to come. After all, there are a lot of wood creepers here. This is a tiny bird species that it easy to hear, but difficult to see. I will have to be patient and especially set up the camouflage tent. My patience is put to the test. Only after hours do I manage to take my first shots of wood creepers. It scurries around like a little mouse in search of food. And despite the supposedly good camouflage, I'm sure he has me, or rather the camera lens, firmly in his sights. I've often had this feeling in the camouflage tent. Finally, I enjoy the short hike up the Kalmit. The forest on the way there has something mystical about it. Until you are rewarded at the top with a magnificent view. The weather forecasts predict clearing clouds even on the plain. I decide to head for a mixed agriculture area near the Rhine. There's a lot of reed along the edges of the fields, a hiding place for a very common bird. Halfway along the route, however, I make a photo stop. The view of Hambach Castle, the cradle of German democracy, is well worth it. I set up the camouflage tent before morning coffee. That way the birds can get used to the sight. At least, that's my theory. It's hard to say whether it's really necessary. Anyway, I'm very excited and after a quick cup of coffee, it's off to the hideout. Of course, it would be a mistake to think I am completely unnoticed by the camouflage tent. The birds are irritated and it takes a lot of patience before they show themselves. But I can hear them for quite some time. I want to watch pheasants today. One of the higher ranking hens is the first to emerge from the reed thicket. She has clearly noticed my hiding place. I suspect that the glass of the lens is responsible for this irritation, as a different bird species react differently to it. She remained almost motionless for 10 minutes. I shortened this a little in the film, but I felt like half an eternity. Again and again she looks in my direction. I dare not move. Finally, she relaxed and begins to eat. This seems to be the signal for the other hens in the group. One by one, they venture out into the open. The hens have been foraging for some time when the rooster enters the stage. It seems somehow staged, as if he has been waiting for this big entrance. Even up close, the hens are very well camouflaged in this trouble field. The rooster is much easier to spot. His plumage has not yet changed completely, for the long tail feathers are only just visible. After about an hour, the group retreats in the sheltering thicket. For me, these seemingly mundane birds provided an absolutely thrilling time. Moments when you block out all the sissiness of the world. I love it when a plan works. This quote comes to mind as I drive to the next location with mouse in tow. I am drawn to the Rhine. Good things are often closer than you think. That's more or less how it goes through my head. I've already had a varied few days and the fourth day couldn't start any better. I enjoy the peace and quiet of the ferry pier. There's always a lot of hustle and bustle here at weekends, but now in the middle of the week I'm almost alone. This place is surrounded by flute plain forests, except for the access road. I am accordingly confident about the planned animal observation. It's just a matter of waiting in peace. Indeed, the first cormorant is not long in coming. But robins and wrens were also heard throughout the morning, but more about the latter later. It doesn't take long before I had made possible recordings of the robin. But they also make it easy for the observer because of their low shyness. It's a little more difficult with the lively wrens. Interestingly, they specialize in cars here. As soon as a vehicle is parked, they examine the underside for food. They find food on the underbody, the inner wheels, edges, and in the tire tread. Not so stupid, also I fear there are healthier insects than those coated in wheel rot and brake dust. In conclusion, it becomes clear once again what animal treasure already lie on your own doorstep. You just have to lift them. I haven't driven 100 kilometers yet, and yet I have already experienced so much. And there's more to come because I have a plan. Where the starlings gather for their night rest, it is also a good place for me. I stand on a narrow strip of forest, which is always a bench for animal watching. And if nothing works at all, there is a small stream nearby. So I'm optimistic for the last day too. But for now, let's have something warm to roast. The temperatures are supposed to drop to freezing during the night, and it's already cold enough in the trailer. But when the hot vegetable pan is ready, it will also be at the right temperature. Otherwise, I still have the gas heating. After a cold day, it smells like a star chef in my little gourmet temple. Add a little Parmesan cheese and the evening can end comfortably. I'm surprised by a foggy morning. I decide to go straight to the stream to set up my camouflage tent, because fog and water are a magical combination. The modern camouflage tents are packed small, don't weigh much, and can be set up in a flash. Especially since on a windless day like today, I don't need the tent peg for stabilization. Again and again, I'm surprised how quickly the wildlife around the camouflage tent calms down, especially when the conspicuous person inside has disappeared. Many of the little teals are swimming around relaxed in groups, and there is also quite a bit going on in the bare branches above the water. Here are tail tits foraging for food. With artistic skill, they clamber round on the thinnest branches, always balancing with their long tails. They feed on the smallest insects and move to the next tree after only a few minutes. The winter goldcrests are no less industrious in their search for tidbits. At 4 to 7 grams, they are the smallest and lightest birds in Europe. At some point, a water rail passes by. It doesn't seem to mind the camouflage tent either. Just before I was about to stop, some teals came very close to my hiding place. A day that could not have been better. Back at the trailer and a warming cup of coffee, something rustles in the bushes. I hold the camera on it and search. Well hidden behind a leaf sits a winter goldcrest and then makes off scolding. The planned time is up. It's time to get the mouse ready for the journey and make the short trip home. And as if I hadn't seen enough already, I notice a white egret in the middle of a flock of sheep, not 2 kilometers from home. So I stop short and take the last shots on the trip. In this exciting time, the few days are a message for the soul. I have to think of the people living in a big city, maybe still in a small flat. But maybe that doesn't matter. Young or old, small, flat or large, without imagination and a little action, one will go crazy at some point. And we have to go through it. Nature is merciless and we are also just a part of it. I'm more than aware of this as a nature filmmaker, who often enough focuses on the smaller dramas. Perhaps I have given some of you a little diversion with the short reports on this nature journey close to home. In this time of isolation, distance and frustration, the voluntary eremitage with its focus on our nature seems very valuable to me. An hour in the park, a day in the forest or an overnight stay in the car on the outskirts of town in a field. There are so many ways to clear the brain. Only those who do nothing, sure.